So today's first speaker is Dr. Sandhya Koushika. She's going to talk about regulation of axonal transport. Sandhya, floor is yours.
Can you hear me? It's on? Okay, great. So what Debashish said is that one third of it has to be introductory stuff, and then a third has to be at next higher level, and then I'll attempt to do that. I don't know how successful I'll be. Please ask questions, because I think, if I'm not mistaken, I'm the first biologist to speak in this conference. Okay, so those of you who are here and who are hearing me, you know that you're able to do that because of your nervous system. The nervous system is an animal evolutionary, I think, very nice addition to life, which allows you to sense information around you, integrate that information, and transmit a response. The way this occurs, the nerve system occurs, is through wired network, where there are cells called neurons. In this case, here is a description of a network which probably most of you have seen in a school textbook, somewhere on fifth or sixth standard. And this is the reflex arc which all of you have experienced at some point, where if you hit your elbow against some edge, you have a pain response, and then you withdraw it, so you know that, you know, you've seen something that you want to respond to. The underlying cells are one set of neurons which sense the response, which convey information to another set of neurons. And then finally, the last set of neurons, which are called motor neurons, none of the names are important. Third component of the circuit allows you to move your hand out of the way by allowing the muscles to actually function. The way these wired circuits and these cells can be extremely long. For instance, for someone who's a sports person, having a toe injury is very serious, right? I mean, I've seen many sports people, cricketers as well as you know, footballers who have a toe injury and can't play, and you look at them and they're perfectly okay. Those are pain stimuli which can travel between the toe all the way to your spinal cord. So these neurons can be very, very long. And the way neurons communicate with each other is typically, or the major component of it, is called chemical synapses, where neurotransmitters are chemicals which are released by the neuron and touch another cell, could be another neuron or the muscle, which then gives you a functional output. In the reflex arc example that I gave, the functional output would be moving your muscle. In the reflex arc itself, one neuron has to talk to another neuron to convey pain or touch stimuli. This sort of chemical neurotransmitters are filled in these little bags called vesicles, which are essentially lipid-filled, and many people have alluded to in this conference, which are filled with chemicals like neurotransmitters or other peptides. And this, as I said, these vesicles are collected and enriched in these chemical synapses. They dock and release neurotransmitter. So one of the reasons why people got interested in the nervous system, there have been lots of reasons why, but one of the reasons why people started looking at axons much more seriously was due to war. What happened in World War II was, this is the first war where there were a lot of planes, all flown by very young people, mostly men, and you had anti-aircraft fire, and by no means were planes as safe as they are today. So you had a lot of crashes, people falling out of the sky and having catastrophic injuries through their spine. Those people essentially were debilitated and were handicapped for the rest of their remaining life, and people figured out one of the reasons was because the neurons which were in the spinal cord, which allowed you to sense information and transmit it, at least for motor movement, did not regenerate after injury. So I'm giving you a little bit of history, because if what I'm going to present to you is a modified assay, which was how, what was present inside neurons and what was present inside these wires or these axons was first looked at. But the same modified assay will come up in the last part of my talk. So Paul Weiss did this very elegant experiment where he took these various animals. He did cats, he did rabbits. He saw these neurons. He tied a little suture around the axon, waited for a while, several weeks sometimes. And then what he saw was essentially invariant dependent on which neuron he looked at. He would see this little swelling taking place here and little swelling taking place from the synapse back to the cell body. What this actually showed, that flow occurred inside neurons, that there was movement of material that takes place inside these long wires or axons. So when you think in terms of the synapse, that means material is moving to the synapse and moving away from the synapse. A couple of decades later, or even probably more than that, skipped a slide, apologize. This is a movie that comes from Ron Vale's lab, where you lay out, so how does movement take place inside neurons? Again, you've heard it from talk yesterday, which was talking about T-cell synapses, but other ways too in this meeting. Now you have these cellular loads called microtubules, which are these long polymers. You heard that from Raja's talk as well. And you can have movement of cargo here, vesicles moving along these microtubule tracks in an in vitro dish. So you recognize through these sorts of experiments that movement inside neurons use microtubules as cellular loads, and vesicles could move along it. We now know that this movement takes place through molecular motors. Over here is described molecular motor kinesin, and this is from the inner life of the cell when it first came out. It was really very exciting to watch with some very snazzy music. But essentially, the motor walks on microtubules in a hand-over-hand mechanism, dragging cargo along with it. Okay. So the entire layout is axonal transport takes place on cellular loads, long-distance cellular loads called microtubules, using molecular motors. Transport of cargo in axons is an essential process. Synaptic vesicle proteins, which I already showed you in this electron micrograph, are a very abundant cargo present in all neurons. They are of defined composition at synapses, and we'll come back to it. But essentially, many of these proteins are compartmentalized into little vesicles coming from the Golgi, which is, again, something that Raja talked about, these little membrane compartments which do sorting and packaging of material. These vesicles then recruit, in the case of synaptic vesicle, a very important motor called KIF1A or UNC104, or a synaptic vesicle motor, if you don't want to remember terminology. This motor cargo complex enters the axon. This is a microtubule-dependent motor, walks along tracks, hops off the track, hops back onto another track, and comes to the synapse. Then the vesicles dock, and they release neurotransmitter. And then the cycle resumes by some of these membrane compartments going back to the cell body, now using a different molecular motor which walks on microtubules called dynein. In addition to microtubule tracks, of recent interest and really very great interest, and in fact, Pramod is here as well, who looks at the cytoskeleton but also at actin, that actin is another short polymer which is present for both structure, which is sort of a structure element holding the axon in place, as well as giving you short tracks where short distance transport can take place. But majority of transport that takes place in axons is dependent on the microtubule transport system. So the very simple question when you look at all of these things, when you make precursors in the cell body, they move, they go to the synapse, is to ask a very simple question: are there traffic rules in vivo in neurons? And the answer is going to be three parts, which I'm going to attempt to share with you today. The first part is the cargo. If you ask any biologist, while they'll be interested in motors, especially if you're a neurobiologist, you're much more interested in the cargo. You're interested in cargo because the cargo is what executes neuronal function. Synaptic vesicles are very, very important for neurotransmission, as are other kinds of cargo like mitochondria, which I'm not going to talk about today. So we'll start with cargo, we'll move to the environment in which vesicles move, and finally I'll give a small piece about motors. And the last of it is not published or written up in any shape or form. So bear with me if you know parts of it are unclear. So the purpose of my talk is to get you to appreciate what are the types of experiments that in vivo biologists who look at whole organisms, like I do, using the C. elegans, doing in vivo imaging, not in dissociated cells, in situ, in a living organism, what is the kind of data that you can get and what it allows you to interpret? And how far do we as experimentalists have to go to have a fruitful conversation with theorists or any sort of people who do modeling or theoretical approaches? So, as I said earlier, the synaptic vesicle is a defined organelle. In fact, it is a lipid ball whose content was characterized with for the very first time. And there have been since many other types of organelles which have been characterized, but this was the very first which had such level of detail. So you know that certain proteins, synaptobrevin, which is a snare, which is required for vesicle fusion with the plasma membrane to release neurotransmitter, there are 70 proteins present on the vesicle. Synaptobrevin, which is what allows you to sense calcium, which triggers that release, 15 copies of it. So on and so forth. So you have very defined composition. But when they come from the cell body, where they come from this Golgi sea that Raja described, the sea of the Golgi has all proteins mixed together irrespective of where they end up on which membrane. They have to be separated from it. For instance, I'm going to show you one set of movies. Here is a wild type animal, and what you will see is you have marked a synaptic vesicle in green, and you've marked the Golgi resident enzyme in red. And what you see in the axon is the green is what is you're seeing moving in the axon. The compartment which has both the synaptic vesicle protein and Golgi actually goes back to the cell body. Here is a mutant. In this mutant, the separation of Golgi enzymes from synaptic vesicles is broken down. So what you see in the axon is both of these compartments moving together. Okay. I'll show you another example. And here is an example where we are looking at another protein, which is lysosome, which degrades things in your cells. And what you look at here is a synaptic vesicle protein, very few lysosomal proteins in the axon. Most of them in the axon, which is going to the synapse, is synaptic vesicle protein. What you see in this mutant is both of them are moving together. So clearly there are mechanisms in the cell to separate these kinds of proteins so that your axon has preferentially one class of proteins entering on vesicles and not other. One way to think about the problem, this is the way, and I'm not talking about all the genetics and biology that we do to discover these pathways, but one way you look at this problem is to ask, what is present on the cargo surface, and whether what is present on the cargo surface dictates whether a motor gets recruited to it. And here, the synaptic vesicle motor. Okay? And I'll show you how those experiments look, and I'll give you a schematic at the end of it, because I don't want to dwell on this part of the talk. So again, looking here at a synaptic vesicle protein in a wild-type animal, looking at one specific neuron that we look at very frequently, you see a lot of cargo present, a lot of synaptic vesicles present at the synapse. And we can look at these other mutants, there's a lot of synaptic vesicles present at the synapse. When you look at a motor mutant, this is a synaptic vesicle motor mutant, you see nothing is present in the synapse. Hardly anything is present in the axon. A lot of it is stuck in the cell body. So this allows you to deduce that this motor is critical for moving synaptic vesicle proteins. Now, I showed you these two different mutants, it doesn't matter which those mutants are, in which what was coming out into the axon was mixed up. They were not synaptic vesicles anymore, they were mixed with Golgi resident enzymes or lysosomal enzymes and things of that nature. So when you have messed up your cargo in this way, are you still able to recruit the synaptic vesicle motor, or now you don't care and anything goes? And the answer is, I won't be here, anything goes, right? So here's an animal which, you know, things got to the synapse, you've removed the motor, and you think synaptic vesicles still get to the synapse. There's absolutely no problem at all. So essentially, you've changed the cargo altogether. So the engine doesn't matter anymore, right? You've just completely messed it up. Likewise, you can get a different sort of answer. In this mutation, where the cargo was slightly better formed, not showing you data for that, you now, in this mutant, where it can get to the synapse on its own, you remove the synaptic vesicle motor. You don't get all the way to the synapse, but you get partway into the axon. And this tells you that you have different degrees of recruitment of the motor onto the cargos that are made in these different mutants. So from these sorts of experiments, by doing imaging as well as genetic analysis, what you can conclude is that cargo is central to the type of motor that you recruit and the numbers of motor that you recruit. And this is what we think is going on. In wild type, you have a certain degree of motors. I've drawn that schematically as 2. I don't know if it is 2. I don't know if it's 5. And I certainly don't think it's 20. What you see in one of the mutants that we've actually shown, that multiple motors are involved in moving this particular cargo. In yet other mutant where, you know, the protein came out some, the vesicles came out part of the way, but not all the way to the end till the synapse, we think that it's recruiting far fewer number of motors, and we will ignore this last bit, which is part of another story. So the first thing when you think about transport, for me as a biologist, and it's probably slightly unusual way of thinking about it, is that the cargo matters. And what is present and how you sort that cargo decides whether you can recruit a particular motor on its cargo surface. So that's the first message I'd like you to take. So if you're doing axonal transport, once you've made the right cargo, you want to get out and get up to the synapse. And actually, there are many, many constraints on cargo flux in an axon. And I've talked about this many times, including the prior version of the meeting, which was held in 2017. And this is not a trivial question to ask, because the sources of constraints on cargo transport come in multiple forms. One is, unlike the cells, the beautiful cells that were shown in the immunological synapse or dividing cells, they are enormous in size. The axon is an extremely physically narrow geometry. It doesn't matter which animal you look at. So first, you have the limitation of that. So if you're thinking in terms, and this is a very beautiful experiment which was done by Frank Perez many, many years ago now, where the main cytoskeletal elements, like microtubules, he would just completely get rid of them. Then he would induce formation of vesicles from the Golgi, and then he would just wait. And given 20 minutes, things will leach the cell surface in a non-neuronal cell. So you can say perhaps diffusion is sufficient. It'll take a lot of time, but it'll get there. You can do a similar experiment in a neuron. Nothing gets to the synapse. We finally did that experiment not that long ago, probably last year, when we set up the same system in vivo in C. elegans. So diffusion is not an answer, no matter how long you wait. So what's so unique, aside from the narrow geometry of the axon, about the intracellular milieu of the axon? And one thing which is very, very clear, and you'll see this in these electromicrographs from Hirokawa, is it's actually very, very crowded. You have a lot of cytoskeletal, you have cargo of different size. Aside from that, I already mentioned that you have actin which is present, which can form a mesh-like structure, also hold up the plasma membrane in the axon, but also do other things. And these are present as rings along the axon, probably much more than that. Some neurons are filled with microtubules. These are microtubules which are present. This is the diameter of the neuron. Some are not. So you have all of this heterogeneity present in an axon, which makes it a challenging and non-uniform environment for a vesicle to move. I've already shown you some movies, but I'll show you this one simply because I think, being single color, it illustrates certain principles. The first of them is you can just trap the C. elegans animal, which I wanted to show you, and then turn on the laser light, or here in this case might be fluorescence, and just watch movement. And what you see is cargo move in both directions. So let's move it back again. Cargo move in both directions. We also see that cargo doesn't move at all. And in fact, it was looking at such movies, and such movies can be converted into chymographs, which I essentially convert each frame of the movie into a black and white image. So you can track every single vesicle. Some vesicles go towards the synapse, some vesicles move away from the synapse, some vesicles pause for certain times and start moving again, and there are vesicles which don't move at all. We had gone to Gautam Menon, who was a physicist in IISc, but now is at Ashoka, to discuss some other aspects of our work. And when he looked at these chymographs, he repeatedly asked me, why do you have stationary vesicles? And it seemed like fruitful to try to investigate that question, which we had not hitherto, or nor had others done seriously. So we went ahead and made sure it was not an artifact, which is always important in experiments, and that they were really present, and they seem to be in any system that we have ever looked at or others publish. You see that some cargo are stationary, sometimes a significant number of them. And one of the things that we investigated and identified was these cargo were present at actin-rich regions. And the way you do these experiments is much like the dual color images that I showed you earlier. Now you instead label actin here in red and look at synaptic vesicles in green. And you see, and then you just count what the degree of overlap is and where they are overlapping. And what we saw is a large number of synaptic vesicles were present at actin-rich regions. And then, like all good biologists, just because they are present together doesn't mean it's meaningful. It may be completely unmeaningful. It might be just by chance. It might be just something that happens which really doesn't play a role. So you do the next experiment, which you've done not only with drugs, but with genetic tools, where you inject a drug, where you depolymerize actin. So you depolymerize actin here to various degrees, depending on drug concentration. And we've looked at both Drosophila and C. elegans. We won't go into the details of it. What you see is the density of vesicles that are stalled go down, commensurate with the reduction in enrichment of actin-rich. It was at this point Parul, my student, started, and Parul and I and Gautam started thinking about this problem much more deeply. And our idea was that what you have is some kind of physical crowding in the neurogeometry of the axon, which now prevents cargo movement. So it's not a chemical regulatory process, but some sort of physical regulation. And Parul came up with this very nice idea, saying that we have all this dual color imaging. Let's go back, Sandhya, and check to see where moving cargo stall. Do they stall in specific places which are consistent with our model? Yes. That doesn't happen. So in axons, microtubules are oriented such that the growing end is always facing the synapse. I'm sorry I didn't make that clear when I did my introductory slide. Short range, you mean to say that there's one microtubule which ends with a plus end and there's someone else which is, you can actually face the opposite direction. If you had actually looked at those movies, you would see that it's something which has always puzzled us. Synaptic vesicles that we have looked at in any neuron of C. elegans that we have looked at largely move in one direction or the other. We actually see very few reversals. So we think that that might not be a major issue. But just wait for the later part of this talk where we think reversals will be an issue. Okay? Also, microtubules, in case you don't know, in neurons are extremely stable. And they are not, they are very, very different from the kind of dynamicity you will see in a regular cell, which is not even undergoing division. That would be considered, I think, an interface cell. Microtubules are extremely dynamic, not so in neurons. Okay, so what Parul saw was the following. She looked at moving vesicles. She categorized all of them as saying, are there regions which have just actin but no stalled vesicles? Are there regions which have just stalled vesicles? And are there regions which have both? So she again looked at it in two different systems. We'll just look at the C. elegans data. In a place where there was neither actin-rich region nor any stalled vesicle, majority of the vesicles just go through there. It's like driving in the middle of the night on a highway. There's absolutely no obstacle. You're happily going unless you decide to pull over. If you have actin-rich regions, and this surprised us when we first saw it, you saw that some number of vesicles stalled, but not everything. Majority still went through. So actin in itself does not seem to be sufficient to cause stalling. When you have actin-rich regions, no actin-rich regions, and just a stalled vesicle, it's a vesicle is just stopped for whatever reason, and there's another vesicle that comes by. So I think of it as a truck which is stalled on a regular Indian market road, and something comes behind it. I have a large number of things which do stall. But the strongest, the largest number of vesicles stopped, where you had both an actin-rich region and a vesicle that was stalled. And the same thing that was seen in Drosophila neurons as well. So one possible interpretation of this, that physical crowding can induce traffic jam. I can take questions here, and I can also show you a movie about how that looks. That's an actin-rich region. This is a rare event, actually. And you will see that a vesicle stops. Play that back again. There's a vesicle that moves. It's a synaptic vesicle, actually. Stops at an actin-rich region. Okay. What you know, if you think that this is due to physical principles, then it shouldn't matter which cargo you look at. Right? Because each cargo has a certain identity. I already made a big deal out of how identity of the cargo matters, and therefore the identity of the motor as well. And we certainly know that these cargos, RAB3, which is a synaptic vesicle marker, or RAB5, which is an endosomal marker, both work on different, are both moved by different motors. What you see is RAB3 stops at mitochondria, RAB5 moving vesicles stopped at RAB3, so endosomes stop at synaptic vesicles, they can stop at mitochondria. It doesn't matter what's in front of you. It doesn't matter if you're a truck, it doesn't matter if you're a large car, you will stop behind it, or you can stop behind it. Essentially telling you that a physical explanation may be sufficient to cause stalling, rather than some sort of vesicle-vesicle interaction which is specific to vesicle type. Although we think there is some little role that can play, but we have not explored that. So now we'll move to more recent work, where we asked a very simple question. So there's been a long stream of interest in the system, also from the disease angle. And if any of you are thinking about, you know, infectious disease is the thing to do, my personal view is we understand a lot about infectious diseases, and COVID was a fantastic example of how much and how well we understand and can combat it, because within a year or a year and a half, we had a vaccine. However, neurodegenerative diseases are still extremely refractory to treatment. Think about dementia, think about Parkinson's, and any of those. Yes. Very few. What starts it? So I think one of the things that might start it is that the motor just falls off the microtubule. And if the motor falls off the microtubule, then you're more likely to stop. And then your chances of your motor falling off and therefore not being able to reattach and start moving again might depend on the immediate milieu that you're in. So if you're in a more crowded milieu, perhaps even if a motor can attach, your ability to start moving again might be compromised. That's one way we think about it. Consistent with that, we find that when we vastly overexpress the motor, we still see stalled vesicles. The behavior of vesicles at individual stalls is still the same, but the total number of, there's a small reduction in the total number of small stalled vesicles. Suggesting that if you have vast over excess of motor, you have a small signature there. And I can come back to the end why I think it's not a big signature. But we did both. We did both a drug, and we also did a genetic manipulation.
Near the,
Sorry, the drug depolymerizes actin. So the crowding is not more. Overall, the crowding goes down. Overall, the crowding goes down. So the actin-rich regions go down by 30%, and the density of stalled vesicles go down by 30%. The fraction of mobile vesicles goes up. So now they don't stall as much, which is data I haven't shown you. How? Sorry? It's not all gone. That's why I said there's a 30% reduction. If you put very high levels of an actin depolymerizing drug, or when we do a genetic manipulations, we express the depolymerizing peptide in very high amounts, the whole neuron is messed up. You don't want to do any experiment when the neuron is all swollen and looks horrendous. So you have to titrate it so that you give it in the light level, the neuron still looks largely okay, and then you can interpret the data. Anything else? Okay. So, as I said, if any of you are interested in problems in neurodegeneration and think that theoretical approaches will work, please consider those. Those are tremendous public health problems for which we don't yet have any answers. Okay, so one feature of neurodegenerative diseases, and here I'm showing tauopathy axons, which is, gives you dementia, Alzheimer's disease, or you see here a C. elegans, but you can look at Parkinson's, you can look at a large number of them. Here are human postmortem neurons. Here's mouse transgenic, which has tauopathy, you know, particular kind of tau mutations expressed. And here's C. elegans neurons. And in all of them, you will find clumps of proteins or swellings in the axon. And often there'll be these aggregates that are present in axons. And here is it in human axons, here it is in C. elegans, and here is it in mouse. So we consider two hypotheses. That if you have these kind of locally increased crowding that you see in these diseased neurons, you can get increased stalled cargo just because there's increase in physical crowding. Or there's a second hypothesis that any sort of stalled cargo that you get, and what you see with stalled cargo is those traffic, little traffic congestions, and this Debashish is not, here he is, right. So the last talk in 2017 I called it a traffic jam, and he corrected me. It's a small traffic congestion. These traffic congestions still does not mean that all traffic stops through that area. Vesicles still go through that, right? But when you're looking at an exaggerated place where you have many more protein clumps and other kinds of clumps present in the axon, it is possible that what are normal mechanisms to bypass traffic jams or congestions in axons are compromised. Both of these are possible. So the first question in this is, how do you get past traffic congestions in a healthy neuron? And here the approach that we took was really driven by what Gautam was doing, because that was allowed us to ask what the role of some of these processes will be, which will be very, very difficult to address as an experiment. And here's where I think for a biologist like me, theory shines, because it tells you possibilities that you as an experimenter can consider, at least to do experiments which will be consistent with the hypotheses that are developed, or wait for a new technique to emerge and then allow you to test that hypothesis, okay? So what Gautam showed, so he used some of our data, early data about the nature of cargo movement, to come up with certain basic simulation parameters. And here's what he saw. Here's a vesicle which is moving along microtubules that he has simulated. There are about 10 of them. And you see this single vesicle which is moving. It's going to come, vesicles will stop at the end of a microtubule track, and it will, all transport will stop, unless a vesicle can switch tracks in this case or do reversals. And here's the simulation data, where you have a regular rate of being able to switch between tracks or do reversals. And if you reduce that rate, then the amount of cargo flows goes down. And what I showed you in that movie was almost no movement will occur. And that depends on sidestepping and reversals. Or more recently, what Reshma did was to show that here's your, in gray is the number of stalled vesicles. The number of stalled vesicles really goes up and completely everything stalls if there are no reversals. And the number of stalled vesicles really dependent on reversal rate. So the two ways in which you can relax a traffic congestion, you can walk, jump onto another track, which is exactly what a human driver would do if he's driving on a multi-lane load. He says a little congestion in his road, he's going to go on to the other lane or do a reversal. What I call a spatial relaxation of a traffic congestion and a potentially a temporal relaxation of a traffic congestion where you do a reversal, go back, and then sample the same area over time. Okay, do vesicles reverse in neurons? And we can't look at sidestepping in axons. We just don't have the resolution. And here is a movie where, again, the red is the vesicle and green is the actin-rich regions. And you can see it's nicely doing reversals, doing repeatedly reversals. And I just wait for it. Comes to another region, do reversals repeatedly. And then finally, get out of this place. Yes, yes. Sometimes it does, but mostly it doesn't. So if it moves, it'll move by about, you know, half a micron or so, very little. But most of the time it doesn't. Most of the time it's like rocks, won't do anything at all. Essentially because each of those vesicles has anywhere between 2 to 4 vesicles. So unless they're sort of tied in some way, the whole mass is not going to move. You'll find things emerge from it, definitely. In fact, vesicles that come and stall in such locations will stall for far longer and then emerge. When they normally stall in other places where there isn't this crowding with other vesicles, they'll stall for far shorter time. So we've looked at all of those things. So where do vesicles reverse, synaptic vesicles reverse in the axon? And what we saw was, what Kirtana saw, was synaptic vesicles reversed not at locations where you have stationary cargo. Here's one such example, but tended to reverse where there were stationary cargo were not present. A small number of things which were further. So in the simulation, you can ask this question, which we can't do in an experiment. Does it matter where you do your reversal? Does it matter if you do a reversal where there is a small traffic congestion, or do you do a reversal at some other point? And here's the data of the simulation, where there are 100 reversals you can do at the place where there's a jam, and 1 reversals you do elsewhere. And you see, there's a lot of current, right? There's a net current is very high. But when you go the opposite direction, where most of your reversals are not at places where there is a congestion, but actually take place in where there is no congestion, and there's 1 reversal which takes place at congestion, it's not as if your current falls to 0. There's still some current. And where we are in our experiment is somewhere close to here. So we have some current taking place, and you have reversals taking place anywhere along the neuron. Yes. Okay. I will make sure we reference you. You may not be referenced now by our archive manuscript, but we'll make sure we do that. No, it's important that we do. That's true. So you're still thinking in terms of 1 microtubule. As a biologist, I also think about many different microtubules. And that the motor, yes, I know. So the motor, what I'm thinking also is that the motor detaches. You have a big surface area of the vesicle. There are multiple microtubules. And in fact, this is an excellent example. Look at the number of microtubules which are there in this particular neuron. And you could connect to something else altogether. So we can't even see lane changing in vivo, in axons. We can only look at reversals. So there is no way for us to interrogate that. But reversals is something we can look at. We have tried very hard, and I think we, with a new system which we've just installed, we might be able to look motor and cargo together. I don't know how many times we've struggled with that particular problem in vivo, which might allow us to answer at least some of these questions, not all. Okay, but thank you for that. So what was the initial hypothesis? That crowding may play a role in neurodegenerative diseases by either just increasing number of places where you can stall and you have this physical crowding, or you have mechanisms to bypass like reversals that a simulation suggests might be important, might not function as well. So to test this, we looked at a tauopathy model of C. elegans, the same tauopathy model that I showed you a picture of, where you can see clumps along the axon of cargo and clumps of protein as well, and then asked what happens to synaptic vesicle movement. Okay, so here's what we see. Here's what happens. Neurodegenerative diseases happens later in life, unless you have a genetic disorder of some sort, and you know it comes due to familial reasons early. But typically, it's a late onset disease. So we're looking through multiple days. You look at a young animal, it's not even an adolescent. You can say an adolescent. Look at 1 day animals, 3 day animals, and 5 day animals. So as the animal is aging, and what you see in wild type animals is your reversal rate of synaptic vesicles goes up as you become an adult and stays fairly high. What happens in your crowding tauopathy model? Reversal rate goes up, not as high. You initially start off just fine, exactly like your healthy animals, and then it begins to drop. What do you see with your stalled vesicles? Your stalled vesicles just go on increasing after that initial time where it is not very different from wild type. You just keep on increasing. And your net current begins to decrease. So what's very, very clear here is the ability to do reversals might actually be very important to prevent the catastrophic loss of movement of cargo. And if you don't have movement of cargo taking place, eventually your synapse will starve of synaptic vesicles. And this is a very, very established phenomenon in many neurodegenerative diseases where you have dying back of the synapse, that the synapse begins to detach and the entire neuron begins to die because it's not nourished. It's like having a home in which no produce comes, right? So you can't have any, you can't basically do anything. Here's another way of looking at the same thing. You have, if you look at percentage of long-lived stationary cargo, your pink is your crowding neurodegenerative disease tauopathy model, and your wild type is gray, and you see that you have far fewer reversal rates. Likewise with current. Okay, so I'm not saying anything which I have not said before. So to summarize this part of the talk, what I want you to take away from it is that stationary cargo is a feature of axonal transport. It arises from the way axons are designed. The design principles are irrespective of any animal you look at, and this will apply to any other cell which has a narrow, thin geometry, of which there are few. You will find that you will have vesicles that are stalled due to crowding, due to lack of space, and due to the arrangement of the cytoskeleton. So traffic congestions is present in healthy neurons and is a part of life. And if I had to take a message from it, which I say in every talk, when you're driving on Indian roads and you come across traffic congestions, you have to be zen about it. This is what your neurons are dealing with every day. Finally, reversals and potentially its location as suggested by simulation might matter to maintain cargo flow. And reversals are compromised in crowded sick neurons, which seems to have an effect in how much cargo movement takes place. So reversals might be central to allow cargo flow to be maintained in diseased neurons. And if you could think of ways to keep maintaining that reversal, you might actually keep your neurons healthier for longer. Okay. I have 10 more minutes and I have about 5 minutes of talk. And are there any questions on this part before I move to the last? Yes. No, unlikely. So we, because the orientation of microtubules is such that the plus end of the microtubule in these cells, in these axons, are oriented towards the synapse. The anterograde movement is controlled by the kinesin motor, here the synaptic vesicle motor, ANK1A4 or KIF1A, and the retrograde movement, which we have shown in other studies, is dependent on dyne, which is a minus end directed motor. So So some switching between motors does occur. It's just that majority of the vesicles still move in one direction or the other. So if you remember what I said, it is not just the actin-rich region alone which is important. Your greatest number of stalls occur where there is an actin-rich region and a vesicle present. And please think of this probabilistically. It's not that every vesicle that encounters it will come to a stall. This is what we're able to see. It could be that locally, when a vesicle comes, the membrane of the especially in this case, it may not matter that it can flatten. But some of the vesicles that we look at, especially in mutants, are larger tubes. And we can actually see them wiggle. You can have that. Locally, your axon can be slightly broader, giving you more space. And that kind of information you will not have. It's like looking in Google Maps and you driving in the place where it is yellow, right? You will know that you can get through. But Google Maps will tell you it is a very difficult place to get through. That's because these local decisions are all things we are able to interrogate. Eventually, yes. Yeah. They'll reach the synapse and then start from there. They occur throughout the neuron. There is no place in the neuron which does not have a large number of microtubules and does not have stalls. At least we have not seen it. We have not seen any difference. Everywhere, it's essentially the same. As I said, it comes from the design principles of the neuron itself. Yeah. No, it's the design principle. The neuron is designed. You know, there are reasons why the neuron has the narrow diameters, and that's for the electrical properties of the neuron. If they get too broad, then you can't get efficient electrical conduction taking place. So you have to optimize the diameter of the neuron. The largest diameter neurons you see are escape neurons in squid, but most neurons are very narrow. And so you have the design principle hardwired in. Yes, it can. Vesicles alone are sufficient. That's where we don't think of a model where actin and myosins on the cargo surface or myosins on actin to trap vesicles is necessarily something which is the primary reason to account for these stalls. Fewer. They never will be zero. If they're zero, then you know nothing will get there. Yes, we do. Yes, we do. Yes, we do. And in fact, one thing which I did not emphasize is that I think stalled vesicles are a major source. So you have to think of it as niches. And I think Ramre, I don't know Ramre if you're going to talk about niches, but when you think about a particular environment, there are many components in that environment which are going to be important. Actin-rich regions is one. Ends of microtubule is another, which we have not looked at, but has been looked at by Shaul Yogev. So we've not looked at that. So some of the stall vesicles are going to come at end of microtubules, but some of them is just vesicle stalling because, you know, somehow the motor fell off, just chance. Some of them is going to be mitochondria present, and they are anchored over there for other reasons, right? So you have a multiplicity of reasons why vesicles stall. Actin-rich regions with stalled cargo is one amongst them. And we can see signatures of it, I think, because it's so abundant. Yeah. That is one of them, but there are many, many reasons. That's only for AD. That's the case that I made, right? So when you see, if you look at postmortem samples or you look at mouse models, you see these aggregates of proteins present in axons and other sorts of aggregates. You invariantly, anybody has looked at these neurodegenerative diseases, it doesn't matter in which system, you see an increase in stalled cargo. I think what our work provides is the first understanding of why that might be the case and why reversals might be important. So your if you are someone who's thinking about this from a clinical perspective, you might be better off thinking about ways to improve reversals and activate motors rather than trying to see can you dissolve the plaques, because I think that's going to be very difficult to do. So I'll tell you what we have seen. So we've not done, you know, really checked it. When we dissolve actin using latrunculin A, or some of it, or we use a microtubule depolymerizing drug, we see now, you know, I said how these tall vesicles are like rocks. They don't do anything. What we see is some sort of jiggly motion. So presumably now when they are stalled, they have some space to move around. But we've not really investigated that. But again, they don't go anywhere. There's no net, you know, directional displacement. Possibly. I mean, you will have to do those measurements and really make the case that it is there. All I can tell you is that we see a little bit more jiggly motion in things which are supposed we think are stalled vesicles. But they're, again, not going anywhere. Oh, even in Parkinson's, neurons die. Yeah. Pretty much all neurodegenerative diseases, neurons die. You can look at SCA, which is a triplet repeat disorders, ALS, AD, Parkinson's disease, all of them neurons die. Different neurons die. Not the same class of neurons die, but they all die. And they have some common cellular features, but not all. In models where it has been looked at, so of course not in human patients, in models where it has been looked at, you actually see that cargo transport is stalled. So you can look at Drosophila models of AD, you can look at mouse neurons in culture which have expressing particular Alzheimer variants or presenilin variants which will cause that, and you will see these stalled cargo. So dopamine is a neurotransmitter which is filled inside these synaptic vesicles. I don't remember the data for that, but my guess is there is some experiment out there which I've looked at. There are tens of thousands of papers on these. So I can't claim to have read them all. Okay, so that we don't run out of time, I'll come to the last part of my talk, which is what are traffic rules in neurons. We covered cargo, saying cargo is important. The environment matters. And the environment, by design principle, is set up in a way in which you have stalling. And the final component, which I've come to less, which is all unpublished, is actually motor. So I talked about the KIF1A motor, or the synaptic vesicle motor. You don't need to remember what the motor is. Motors, many motors have an auto-inhibited state where they stay folded, and then they unfold upon binding to cargo, or when other proteins bind to it, enabling it to bind cargo. I have an activated motor, which, as many people of you, many of you know, move in either the plus or minus end. In case of synaptic vesicle motor, the idea is that it binds to carbo somewhere in the cell body and then carries it up to the synapse. We had an observation many years ago, and this sort of motor regulation, and motors can be regulated by many ways. You know, other proteins will activate it, therefore you can bind cargo. But there are other kinds of motor regulation that can occur as well, which need not be just unfolding of the motor. So we got into this project, when we did a series of genetic studies where we were looking at cargo binding. And what we learned at that end of that story was that motors actually got degraded at synapses. Here is a mutation in which we've reduced degradation. Here's another mutation, just ignore it for now. I'll come back to it. And what Vidur, my student who's currently working on this project, found that motors get degraded at synapses, and the same proteins which control degradation also led to motor accumulation at the end of the neuron. He was convinced, and this is really his baby, that what's happening in these cases is that some kind of small modification is attached to the motor, and this somehow controls how the motor moves in the axon. I was happy for him to play with this problem, which he did, because we still understand little about how you control numbers of motors on cargo surfaces. And you see what I told you, right? If you vastly overexpress the motor, you will see small effects on something. They said, okay, go have some fun with it, see what you find. So based on the same ligation-like assay that I presented, how axonal transport was discovered, we had developed in our lab a way in which you would ablate the axon. And what we saw with the synaptic vesicle motor is, here's the cell body, here's where you're ablating. You'll see that motor is coming, synaptic vesicle motor carrying cargo to the synapse, or synaptic vesicles to the synapse, would accumulate at the cut site. Very little would come back, because our idea was it was getting degraded. And now when you blocked degradation, you would still see things accumulating at the cut site. But in one case, it was coming back from the synapse now, because it was no longer getting degraded. Let's again ignore this, okay? Because that's not the most important part of this figure, even though it's clubbed with it here. So what Vidur looked at it and he said, we are looking at this an hour after doing this sort of ligation or cutting, which is very different from the several weeks that Paul Weiss waited. But I want to look at it dynamically. And that's exactly what he did. He would do an injury and then look to see what happened. And what he would see was this increase very quickly of the motor in very top few seconds. You know, it's like less than a minute. In these mutants, you would see much greater accumulation of the motor at the injury site. So what we learned from this is that if you had an altered modification on the motor, you could control the how much motor moved in the anterograde direction. This, of course, led us to look. I have only about four slides more. Rumi, I have four slides more. This led us to look at the motor itself, and this is what we saw. I'm just going to let the movie play and walk you through it. This is a fire representation. This is a black and white representation. And what you'll see, and you can read the fire representation, your bright yellow puncta are very few. Here, there are very many more. And you'll now see the black and white representation. I don't know why it's playing so slowly, and it plays usually really well. Very few, and you'll see very, very many more bright puncta here. So we know that in this mutant that we're looking at, there's reduced modification of the motor near the cargo binding domain of the motor, and we won't get into that today. Okay, so what we saw was these far brighter motor puncta moving around, which we think are actually present on cargo. Here's where we did some theory. This entire collaboration occurred over Zoom during COVID. And I think I've met Amitabha. We started this discussing that we might potentially work together with Amitabha and Debashish, who are going to speak later next week, in 2019 December. And then I think everybody knows what happened in March 2020. And I think I saw him last month or a month before for 10 minutes. So what Debashish and Amitabha did was to say that motors can bind to cargo and can fall off from cargo. So you have an association and a dissociation rate. Very straightforward. And what we did, or what Vidur did, was to look at all these trajectories of motor movement. And what you can see here right away, it's done in the same way, the same time, that they are much, much brighter. And he just would take intensity profiles of every single such moving group of motors, which we thought was on a vesicle. It's unlikely that they are single motors which are moving around inside the axon. And the only way you could fit these curves from their model was if you added a term which allowed for cooperativity. That is, one motor bound now encouraged another motor to bind again. And this seemed to depend on the ability of the motor to be not modified, because what you've done here with these mutants is remove the ability to do the modification. So free motor, which is not modified, can just get on to vesicle surfaces willy-nilly of at least this motor. And this might explain why when we vastly overexpress motor, we don't see any such signature of the kind that we see over here, because those motors, you vastly overexpress them, but they're all modified and therefore cannot get on the motor surface. Okay, so if you put a lot of motors on the cargo surface, what would you expect to get? What you see with in vitro experiments, which I don't know if Roop is going to describe in one of his three lectures, is that if you put a lot of motors onto the cargo surface, what's really seen is that how far the cargo will move or the bead will move depends on that. Okay? Do we see that in vivo? It's certainly much more complex milieu. And what we saw was the following, that the run length or how far, the number of trajectories which were very long and went for further was much, much greater when you removed the ability of the neuron to do this magnification. So idea in that, of course, then changed overall cargo distribution, where you now had accumulation of the cargo at the end of the neuron. So if you remember, I started my talk showing cargo and then showing how you deduce from some steady state images of no movies what motors might be important by just looking at cargo distribution. And we have come full circle again and said this sort of cargo distribution is probably predicated on the ability of the many more motors to be recruited on the cargo surface and for the cargo to move further, therefore ending up much more at the end of the neuron or the end of the microtubule tract. So here's the little schematic where if you normally have modification occurring, you have only one or two motors recruited and you go short distances, you reduce the ability to do modifications, many more motors bind, and then you have long run lengths. And this is all in vivo data. What's interesting, and we don't yet know, we are trying to investigate it, is that cooperative binding might be very important for ensuring that whatever motors are present are actually aggregated and functioning. And there's some precedent, the KIF1A motor for that. And what this regulation might do is control the levels of motor on the cargo surface, which is not only going to control the, how far each individual particle, each cargo will move, but also perhaps behavior of cargo at particular stationary locations. So what you see in wild type is you have a couple of motors maybe, and maybe in this mutant you have four or five or six or many more. We have no way of knowing. So none of this work would have been done without a large number of people. Project was started by a postdoc many, many years ago, Parul. Finished up, the first part was finished up, by Kausalya, finished up by Parul, who is now running her own startup. The reversal story was, really brought to life by Kirtan, and a master's student who's now doing a PhD between Cambridge and KU Leuven, and Amrita, who's will be defending a thesis soon. None of it would have been possible without Gautam or his JRF and students. This is Vidur, my student, who's very brave, and this is Amitabha, Debashish's student, Amir, and Debashish himself. And I thank you for your attention. I'm happy to take a few questions, maybe.
Thank you, Sandhya, for this wonderful and illuminating, very illuminating talk.